According to a recent report from Forrester Research, B2B customers are increasingly copying B2C consumer behaviour and buying more from online and mobile websites. So how do B2B providers respond when it comes to e-commerce? In this programme, we find out. It's no secret that many companies struggle with the concept of B2B e-commerce. According to Intershop's 2013 e-commerce report, 96% of B2B brands find it hard to provide intuitive and user-friendly interfaces, while almost half believe it's difficult to manage complex organisational structures, such as different user roles and multiple business models. So what's the solution? One firm that thinks it knows is $9 billion industrial supply company Grainger, which has over 1 million products in its assortment. Grainger has embraced the B2B e-commerce challenge and won plaudits for its approach. I caught up with Paul Miller, the firm's VP for e-commerce, to find out how he's responding to higher customer expectations in the B2B space.
I think the first thing is, you know, when you think about B2B or B2C or any of the other acronyms that have come about, they're all sort of irrelevant when you think about, you know, just the rough definition of them. The truth is you've got people who are shopping. And if I'm somebody who's used to buying things on a particular website and I'm used to a great experience, when I come into work and I'm buying, I'm not thinking about, oh, well, it's okay that it's a deficient experience because it's B2B. You know, people are thinking about the way that they shop online, the way that mobile is an unbelievably fast experience. So when I think about B2B and when I came here to Grainger and really started to charter the team and the strategy, it was more about understanding where are the gaps from not just the best B2B experience or even within our segments, but where's the gaps between the best experience possible? So if people are searching for products, when you have a million items, that's a lot of product. How do you make that easy? How do you make sure that the person has the complete confidence that they're buying just the right item for them? So you start with that B2B, that B2C experience rather, where it's about understanding and giving a great shopping experience, but layer on top of that the things that make B2B different and nuanced. And I think that's where we've really excelled, is not just kind of setting our bar low and saying, well, there's other folks that do it kind of like this within B2B. It's more been about what's the absolute best that you can aim towards, and then how do you aim to surpass that and continue to reach even higher beyond those levels.
Is there anything in particular that you have brought from B2C to that role in the kind of the B2B world?
It's about really understanding your consumer, your customer. Really diving in and getting a sense of what the unmet needs are for these people. And then trying to delight them. And you know, that's a word that you hear a lot in B2C. You don't hear it a lot in B2B. But I believe it's really important that you have to think about that person in their role and what they're trying to accomplish. And how do you create things, experiences, services, others that really delight that customer and have them want to come back? Because it's made their life so much easier. It's made their job easier, which in turn is a really positive benefit for them.
So what are the headline challenges and how did you tackle these? Obviously you mentioned the million products earlier on. Is that one of the main challenges or are there others?
Well, you know, it's interesting. We have a brand within the B2B space that people know, but you know, people don't always know what Grainger sells. They don't always know that this is the product that Grainger has or this is the availability. So the starting challenge is, even when you have a pretty well-known brand, how do you leverage digital marketing to make sure that your message is out there where the customer is? And we started down a path of really expanding our digital marketing efforts to the point where we're now very present where the customer is starting their search. You know, that's a starting place.
Okay, sure. So you see e-commerce and digital marketing evolving in tandem.
Oh, absolutely. I'll use the example of a sump pump. You know, if somebody's out there and they need to buy a sump pump, they're searching for that. They're searching for it on Google. They're looking at blogs. They're trying to understand, for my application, what's the right product for me. And so content and digital marketing become very important as you couple those things together. And that's both off the site as people are researching, but also on the site when people get there. So we might have 12 different brands of sump pumps available. We might have ones that are reviewed by customers who are just like you. And that's where it starts to come together as a total experience. So now I'm out there and I'm looking, but I might be in a particular geography, or I might have particular uses like I'm in a food handling plant where certain regulations or other compliance things would be different. So our goal is to try and make sure that the customer that has different nuanced needs has the ability to figure out, using all of these tools, all of our web and mobile tools, in a very quick fashion, you know, what's the right thing, and then how do I get it? You know, one of the things that we have as a very core strength is the ability to get products to people typically same day or next day. Now, when you think of a million products available and same day, next day, that means supply chain is a very big capability for us. Bringing that all together so the person can discover the product off your site, that they can interact with it on your site, and that you can nail that last mile and get that product in their hands on a consistent basis, that's what drives loyalty. And that's where we have, you know, some of our individual customers could spend $30, $40, $50 million a year with us on our website.
Okay, sure. Now, in the B2C world, the drive towards greater personalization of the consumer experience is changing the way that retailers operate. So how are you integrating offer management, what you offer, where and why, and how a user discovers that product, into the B2B environment?
Now, you think about what does a B2B customer really look for? And again, it's not that dissimilar to what you or I would be looking for in our own personal journeys in shopping. It's, does the person actually know, does the company I'm dealing with know what I need? Do they know what I've bought before? Can they help me to accomplish my tasks? So the notion of personalization for us really comes down to understanding the person's behavior, having the tools available, so if they need to print their invoices off or if they need to be able to access, you know, things they've done before, that's where stuff starts to come in. But then on top of that, making sure that the offers that you present to them, the various products that you might show them, the various, you know, warranties or other things, are all very relevant to what they've done before. And that's probably where, you know, being in the online space is so gratifying, because you have data.
So getting people to engage with you is one part of the challenge. But how do you make it easy to buy?
So we have the ability for people to create an account, to be able to buy on credit. But let's be honest, a lot of times somebody's looking to buy a product and they need it right now. That furnace broke and they need that replacement motor. And they're going to find that Grainger probably has that product and can get it to them today or tomorrow. Now, in that case, what we've done is we've included a guest checkout facility, which ironically is a little bit different for B2B players. A lot of B2B folks figure, you know, you have to create an account. We took the attitude that if a customer is looking for a product and we have it, we can supply it, let's let them be able to check out using a credit card very, very easily. But at the same time, let's make it easy for that person, given that we've got a million product assortment, let's make it easy for them to come back and buy again. And so we made it very simple for the person that's gone through that purchase to be able to come back again and essentially create an account. Now, the bulk of our purchases are from people that have accounts with us and are larger customers. For those folks, we make it unbelievably easy, whether it's, you know, EDI interfaces, whether it's just very simple checkout processes that already have all of their shipping addresses, all of their billing information all loaded in, to make it as seamless as possible, that, you know, one simple click or so and they're done.
Do you think the proliferation of technology platforms is a challenge? Today, e-commerce offerings must encompass websites and mobile apps and social networks, etc. So what are the foundational elements of an effective multi-channel solution?
So first, by understanding who your customers are, and then understanding based on that, what are the tools that make sense for them? So if I'm the person that's out there, and I'm the person that's actually using the product quite frequently, I don't have access to a computer. So how do you make sure that your mobile solutions allow that person to do what they need to do? Now, at the same time, if I flip over to that person who's the procurement person, who's typically buying products on behalf of those users, that person's at a desk most frequently, but let's be honest, they're in meetings, they're walking the floor to talk to the users to see if they're actually, you know, getting what they need, and that person still has to approve orders, that person has to submit things, and so we looked at mobile as one of the things that can actually allow for some of those use cases as well. Now, when you think about it, you've got phones, you've got tablets, you've got computers. We've tried to take an approach that says, what are the things that are unique and special about any of those form factors, and how do you take advantage of those?
Sure, so it all starts with that greater knowledge of the customer.
It has to. If it doesn't, then what you end up with is technology for technology's sake. And, you know, as a team, sometimes we look back and we think about some of the great technology plays, some of the, you know, kind of new cokes, if you will, of the digital space. And they really seem like good ideas, I think, at the time for the people that launched them. But in each case, when you dissect it and you step back, you realize that these things were launched in almost a gratuitous way. They weren't launched from a keen understanding of what that customer really needs. They were launched from something that seemed like it was neat to do. And, you know, we didn't launch, you know, mobile the first day that somebody could. We looked at it and we said, how do we make this an experience that leverages what our customers actually need to do?
Now, you're something of a pioneer in this space, but who do you benchmark against?
I don't just look at folks that are close in, and I go, oh, here are the two or three either domestic or global competitors that look just like us. I think it's important to know what their capabilities are, to respect that and make sure that your customers are getting what they need, you know, vis-a-vis those competitors. But when I think about great search, I'm thinking about companies like Google, where I know that, you know, within milliseconds, I'm going to get a response back that, for the most part, is going to be very, very relevant. So even though some of my competitors have great search, I look at them within kind of our space, but I'll look at best in breed. You know, I'll look at some of the personalization that's out there. I'll look at some of the navigation that's out there. And again, I'm not just going to refine that to the B2B competitors that I deal with. I'm looking more broadly at the full spectrum of digital and saying, who's great at that? And how do I use that as an influence to be able to drive towards a much better experience for our customers?
Sure. I guess the changing nature of customer expectations means that you're no longer competing just against your direct competitors. You're competing against everybody out there who's offering a service.
Well, and, you know, again, the web is the great equalizer. So you're dealing with people that look just like you by having a multi-channel world, but you're also dealing with people that are single channel. You're also dealing with people that are very global. What we find is really kind of some of our secret sauce is that it's the way it all comes together. You know, with a million products and with the level of service that we can give, we're able to help our customers consolidate a lot of their purchases. So as opposed to them dealing with 52 different vendors to support that, you know, purchase of 100 items, they can probably deal with us and maybe one other. And, you know, even, you know, in the case where, you know, piece price comes into play, it's not about that. It's about helping them to save time and money by them being able to consolidate purchases with us. They know that the purchase process is very simple. They know that all of the post-purchase processes are all going to be very tight and very simple.
Okay, Paul, you're in the process of expanding your e-commerce operations. So what's next for you in this space? Where do you see the most exciting opportunities?
You know, our customers are doing things with fewer people these days. They're doing things with tighter budgets these days. And our ability to help them really kind of cements that relationship. And that's what we're seeing. We're seeing a growth rate that's more than double what our base business is, you know, when we look at online. And I think, again, that's because what we're delivering is what our customer needs when they need it. And we're able to really get in there, understand them, and deliver solutions, not just individual items, but solutions that let them do their job so much better.
Okay, and finally, are there any wider external industry trends or developments that are driving your thinking within this space?
So the way that social is going to start to make its way in and permeate B2B, I think it's going to be one of the next trends that we're going to start to see. It's not there yet. You know, people use things like LinkedIn, but it's not part of the shopping fabric really yet from a B2B standpoint. I think in the future you'll start to see that happen a little more. I also think that mobility is going to increasingly accelerate. Adoption is going to accelerate both from a research standpoint, but also from a shopping standpoint. As the apps get better and as the information flow gets faster and more accurate, I think you'll start to see an increasing utilization of mobile.
For more fantastic interviews directly related to your business, be sure to explore Meet the Boss TV.